Hi guys. A couple of weeks ago, we posted a video on our electric catamaran, our boat. I promised in that video that we would be doing a series of shorter technical videos on composite construction. And today what I want to talk about is the use of fiberglass, both as a structural material as well as a surface modification. Now, fiberglass is available in a variety of forms. This is what's called boat cloth. It is a very inexpensive, very common form of approximately 6 to 8 ounces per square yard, or about 200 to 250 grams per square meter in a plain weave, which means simply right angle, up and under, very open weave that is very easy to wet out with epoxy. And it's available on very large rolls. And like I said, it's inexpensive because it's so common. It's also available in what's called a fiberglass tape. This simply has the edges stitched so that it doesn't unravel at the ends. And if you take scissors and cut across here, you can do local reinforcement with this material. It's very convenient to use. Now, this glass is also available in a variety of different thicknesses. This material right here is about 7 or 8 times as heavy, and it has obviously a very, very coarse structure. But it can build up a great deal of strength with just, say, one layer, as opposed to having to put multiple layers of boat cloth down. In addition, you can also obtain a material that has both a fiber, I'll show you on this finer camera, both a fiber weave on the inside, like this, as well as a mat on the back surface that will hold a lot of epoxy and is also very good for bonding to very uneven surfaces. But in all cases here, what we're talking about is what's called E-glass, which stands for electrical grade glass, silicon dioxide. It's the same sort of material that is used to reinforce, say, pre-made panels of glass, circuit boards. It's even useful for the tops of, say, a laser table. It's very homogeneous, it doesn't warp, it's nice stuff. But this is also available in other kinds of materials. For example, this is what's called S-glass. The S stands for structural, but it could also be used to represent sapphire. This is based primarily on aluminum oxide as opposed to silicon dioxide. It is far stronger. It is far tougher. It is also usually available in a much tighter weave pattern, and so it can be a real challenge to get this stuff to apply, to get the surface wetted out with epoxy, but it will produce a higher strength to weight ratio than the typical boat glass, at the cost of a little bit more skill and labor required to put it down. It's actually even tougher than Kevlar. This is Kevlar 29. It's a ballistic Kevlar. And we're going to be working with both of these materials in an upcoming video on soft body armor. So you might want to keep an eye on us for that. But if we return back to Earth and we deal with a simple E-glass for boats, this can be used structurally to create what's called a composite core sandwich. And if you're interested in that and want to get into a lot of the physical principles and the details, take a look at the video that we did about a year ago on composite core construction. But simply stated, if you take a monolithic piece of material and you bend or you stress it, most of the stiffness and most of the strength comes from the surface layers, but the weight comes evenly from the inner layers. And so if what we do is we concentrate the stiffness and the strength in the surface layers and lighten up the core, we can produce a stronger, stiffer, lighter, potentially even less expensive version of the same material, the same panel. This is extruded polystyrene. It's 2.5 centimeters thick or 1 inch thick. It is quite flexible and it's very light. This weighs about 55 grams. However, if we place a layer of the boat cloth on top and wet it out with epoxy on both sides, we've created a sandwich that is far stiffer. Let me give you an example. This is the same panel. It weighs about 10 grams more. If I place this in this vise, lock it down, and I put a lead weight on the end of this, you can see that it hardly bends the panel. I can even put twice as much lead on here. Still can support it. But if I take the same piece of material without the surface reinforcement, place it in the vise like this, and put just one of the lead weights on here, it's just about ready to break. This won't work. So as a consequence, you can use this to make very stiff, lightweight panels. But in addition to that, you can also modify the surface with the same sort of technique. This is plywood, and it is structurally a very solid, strong material. It's actually a composite of glue and cellulose fibers, but it tends to be very soft. And so if you want something that has much greater hardness, the hardness of a plastic boat, but the convenience of the wood, you can simply coat one surface with the boat cloth, wet it out, and you'll produce a much harder surface that's more damage resistant. For example, if I take this styrofoam and I hit it with this ball, I can make a lot of dents in the surface like that. But if I take the fiberglass reinforced material, I can't damage it. So it's got a much greater resistance to damage. It also means that because this has a finite thickness, when I load this with epoxy, I've gotten the same total thickness as maybe 7 to 12 layers of varnish. This means that it's going to be much more resistant to water intrusion, chemically resistant, as well as harder. It's going to add a little bit of strength, but primarily what we're doing is we're making a hard surface. If I coat this sufficiently that all of the weave pattern is filled up and this is glassy smooth, I have what's called a bright finish in boat building. That simply means I can see the grain pattern in here. Now this isn't a beautiful example because I just threw this together as an example last night, but you can still see the grain through here, you can still read through here, so it works very effectively in producing a hard surface, but still a very attractive surface. This is also compatible with paint. So if we want to paint over here, we've gotten the hard surface and a nice surface to paint on, but we've also got damage resistance. In order to apply this, your thought might be, what's the easiest way to do this is simply to take a board, place the cloth on here, and coat it with some epoxy. If I take the epoxy, you can see it's very viscous, and place it on here, I can paint the layers, and I can bring the material from a sort of milky white to a nearly clear, because the refractive index of the liquid and the glass are very similar. So when I remove the air, what I'm doing is I'm actually creating sort of a homogeneous refractive material, and it becomes clear like glass. But the problem with this technique that I'm using right now is that I'm working uphill. All the bubbles that are down here in this sort of waffle pattern of the fibers contain air, and I've got a viscous liquid that I'm trying to get down to the bottom below the air, and so they're having to exchange positions. That's kind of tough, and we're kind of working against gravity. Now, there are a lot of specialty tools that we have and that you can purchase. These are called bubble busters. Because of their corrugations, they produce a lot of pressure that allows you, when you rub this on the surface, to sort of push the fibers down and get the bubbles that are formed underneath to work their way out to the top of the surface. Bubble busters are great when you're doing this with this technique, and you can smooth the surface off and get rid of some of the pockets of epoxy, because it also tends to draw it out. However, there's a much more elegant way of doing this than this, and that is to take advantage of gravity. If we simply place the epoxy on the surface first, and we wet the surface with the epoxy like this, and then what we do is we put the glass into the epoxy. The epoxy is at the bottom, and so the air is already on top, and all we need to do is allow that the fibers to be wicking the liquid up through the material. And as you can see, even without doing anything, just the weight of the glass, you can see this beginning to clarify. I'm not doing anything to it. Now I can speed this up by using my fingers and just sort of move it around, but it's strictly not really that necessary. You can see how much more evenly I can get the application of the epoxy than I got here. It's much less of a mess because I'm not sort of working against gravity. This brings up sort of another point, and that is structurally, as soon as this material becomes translucent, I've gotten all the structural value of linking all those tiny microscopic fibers to each other, and I've formed a structural epoxy composite. And in that case, you would stop. And that's, for example, what you get here. You can hear I have sort of a rough sound because this is rough. It feels rough. And the waffle pattern doesn't matter structurally. But if I want to get a bright finish like this, nice and smooth and hydrodynamically efficient, I'm going to want to fill up that waffle pattern. And even though I'm going to add a little weight, I'm going to get a smooth working surface. Now, your first thought might be, well, just put more epoxy in here. Just load this up like this. Well, the problem with that is that there is a tendency for this to sort of pool in the low areas, and you don't get a very efficient smoothing of this. And as you can see also, it tends to move the cloth around a little bit, so it tends to be a little bit challenging. So in composite or epoxy work, it's very important to take advantage of time. When the epoxy comes in the two components, they're monomers, and when you put them together, they polymerize, and as they do, the mixture begins to thicken, then gel, and then eventually you'll get to the point where it starts to get firm but tacky. When that's occurred, when you no longer can move it around, and when you pull your finger away from the tacky surface, you no longer pull any glue away, you still have a lot of raw monomer ends that are sticking up in the air. And if what we wanted to do then is then take a second batch of epoxy and apply it, we're not going to slide the cloth around. And we've still got monomers that we can covalently bond to and produce a very strong structure. The reason that's important is because if you take cured epoxy, which is fully polymerized, you can't really bond epoxy to epoxy chemically. You can mechanically, and the way that you do that is you will rough up the surface with some sandpaper and create thousands, millions of tiny little pits and grooves that the new epoxy can actually grab onto mechanically, but it's never as strong. In addition, when epoxy fully cures, there is an amine byproduct that forms, and the amine is a water-soluble, that's important, soapy kind of film that will further inhibit the bonding of a secondary coat. So if you are going to do this as a two-step operation with a fully cured epoxy, what you're going to need to do is take a wet cloth of just water, no solvents, no alcohol, nothing else, and just wipe off the surface, get rid of the amine. Then you've got to sand the surface to mechanically prepare it. You don't want to sand the amine into the epoxy. Now you can recoat it. But obviously, you've got to wash it, you've got to sand it, you've got the sanding dust. If you simply use time and wait for the right point, you get a stronger bond, you don't have the mess, but you've got to remember that if you're doing this at 8 o'clock in the evening, unless you're an insomniac, you might want to time what you're doing so that you're going to be around and able to work when this is primed to be able to operate. Another advantage that you can use in terms of lab techniques is, obviously we've used gravity to help us here, and we have used the advantage of the wicking. There's another advantage besides just using time, and that's by modifying the time. If what we do is we want to speed this up, we can use heat. And the trick to using the heat is that for every 10 degrees centigrade increase in the temperature of the epoxy, we will double the curing rate. So if we can take this from, say, 20 degrees lab temperature up to maybe 50 degrees centigrade lab temperature, we can increase the curing rate eightfold, nearly an order of magnitude. And the way I like to do this is to use what are very simple personal heating pads. These pads, we've got about a dozen or maybe 15 of these things, are very inexpensive. If you place a little insulator down, you place one of these pads on the surface like this, then you take a little bit of plastic wrap, put it on top, tear it off, place the material that you want to cure on top of there, place another layer of plastic on here to protect your pads, tear that off, then place another pad on top of here, like this. A little insulator up here is kind of a nice, but not that critical step. And then just take a rag, or a towel, or a blanket, or whatever you want to help hold in the heat. Throw it over the top of this, and you can cure this much more quickly. So by using temperature, as well as by using time as it modifies temperature, we can work with this much more quickly. The nice thing about using this is that you can use very slow cure epoxies. The slower it cures, the more convenient it is. You've got more time for the epoxy to flow out and give you a nice surface. You can make bigger batches because you're not running around and the stuff's going to go off and start gelling and getting hot. So it's nice to use slow cure, but it's also nice not to wait 3 days before you can work with the material. Now, another thing I'd like to show you is that when applying an epoxy to a surface, it is always nice to work with a horizontal surface. The reason being is that you've got gravity holding everything down, you don't have epoxy running off the sides, and so you would like to work on a horizontal surface. So therefore, you don't want to place a lot of epoxy all the way around here and have the sides sort of working on a vertical. So you'll want to work on this side, and then when you're done, you'll want to work on this side. So consequently, you have to deal with this interface, and there's a neat trick to doing that. Let me show you over here. Now what I have is a similar panel in terms of size. And if what I do is I simply take a marker here and I put a couple of dots along here. This is just sort of witness dots that kind of show me what of this glass I'm actually going to end up needing to use. And then what I'm going to do, if I remove this, I can then take pieces of tape that I will place around here like this. And the reason I'm placing the tape around here and much outside of there is because I'm going to take advantage of the fact that the tape, if you cut halfway through it, not only do we end up avoiding the fraying that occurs on these edges from the piece of material that we want to use, but I also protect the stock material, as I have on the other side there, from fraying so that we don't end up with a whole bunch of loose strings hanging off. And I've intentionally cut this way over size, and the reason for that is because what we're going to do is we're going to take advantage of gravity here to cause the material to form around the corners without having to tape it down or to try to support it. And so even though we're going to waste a little bit of material like this, what we're going to do is we're going to form a very nice joint around the corners by taking advantage of gravity. So I'm going to wet the upper surface of this box here. Now what happens is I'm going to put the cloth down on top of here, like this. And again, if we just wait for a little bit of time, you can see how this is beginning to fill up. If I then take the brush and I begin applying some epoxy around the corners like this, what you'll see, I'll come over here because I think you'll get a better view, what you'll see is that I'm applying additional weight as well as pushing the fiberglass down onto that rounded edge. Nice. See how that forms a nice curve? Now, if what I do is I wait on this part for about the same amount of time that I would have waited if I was going to fill this up with a secondary coat of epoxy, in other words, tacky, but still not completely cured and it doesn't pull away, then what I do is I use a razor blade. And I will take the razor blade and I will cut this down. I will draw the razor blade through here as I cut this away. And by drawing it down, I don't tend to peel the surface away because I'm sawing up and down. I will pull it down around there. And as a result, I'll remove about 95% of the material when it's extremely easy to slice through it. And when I'm done, I'll end up with just sort of a ragged edge, like you can, I'll show you on here. You get this little ragged edge here, but it's very small. A little bit of sandpaper and I can get a nice smooth curve all the way around here so that when I eventually then turn this around on its side, it'll be easy to repeat the process and I won't have any sort of overlapping gaps or air gaps underneath here, and I'm always working horizontally. So those are pretty simple techniques, but if you apply those techniques, the temperature, the timing, as well as using gravity to help you, epoxy coating can be very, very powerful in terms of a tool for boat building, and it's easy and it's fun, and when you get better and better with it, you start to think about new things that you can do with it. Next time, what we're going to do is we're going to cover fillers. We're going to use epoxy not just as an adhesive or a coating, but we're going to actually modify it with different types of materials to create a structural compound that can either fill gaps and dents. It can also be used to build up joints that are far stronger than the native material, extremely fast and inexpensive to build. So I want to thank you very much for watching. Please subscribe and try to share what we're doing here because I do want to spread this around as wide and far as possible. But I'll wish you a happy afternoon and safe boat building, and we'll see you soon.